Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very happy to be here with you. It's my second ECRF Cardiff, so let me share you a short story coming from the European Commission. Obviously, I do not represent the Commission in any way. However, it's a pleasure to share this story about the project that is being conducted. So the short story goes, the European Commission had a problem with access to regulated information. We suggested to use the DLT. Now they have two problems. So we have this project called European Financial Transparency Gateway. And the project pretty much starts with the business problem that is Transparency Directive, which has been established quite a few years ago, stipulates something called the European Electronic Access Point. Transparency Directive is this regulation which requires, among other, the companies listed for trading on regulated markets to submit regulated information to a variety of registers. Some of these registers are called OAMs, officially appointed mechanisms, and they need to submit, for instance, annual financial information according to IFRSs or corporate actions or other types of regulated information that's stipulated in the directive and the related commission delegated regulation. So that's sort of like the setup. Now, as you know, Europe is federated, and we've got multiple registries in multiple countries, and we've got almost 27 ways of solving the same problem. So essentially, this listed company in Poland would use slightly different approach to submit this regulated information than a listed company in Germany, and completely different than a listed company in Italy, and a different one than in Sweden, etc. So this started off with how can we make this data accessible to investors, to analysts, the data that is annual financial reports, that is IFRS based in principle. And we had also some circumstances around it. We had the external factors coming into the consideration. These external factors were, among other, also coming from the Transparency Directive. For instance, the European Single Electronic Format, ESMA, mandated that from 2021, all listed companies in Europe have to, on a mandatory basis, use the inline XBRL standard format with the corresponding IFRS taxonomy in order to prepare the financial reports and submit them to the OAMs, to the officially appointed mechanisms. And the OAMs share it with the public, bring it to the public as quickly as possible. So essentially, we are dealing with this complicated environment over there. We also have another aspect. We've got the LEI introduced in Europe. So listed companies have to obtain the LEIs according to a variety of regulations, most of them ESMA regulations for trading, for various purposes. Transparency Directive also requires them to do so, to obtain the LEI. That's pretty much the setup. We've got the standard that is XBRL that provides the structured data and will provide the structured data, but it will only come in 2021. Right now, we still, you know, collect the data in PDFs, in custom XMLs. We collect the data in a variety of forms from the listed companies. And how would you make that available to the investors? How would you present all of that to the analysts who would like to search for this data across the European Union, across the different countries? So again, someone basically started thinking about, if we have the problem defined like that, what kind of technology, what kind of solution would we propose to solve this? And one consideration was obviously, let's build a centralized database. Why not? It's, you know, it's one way to deliver that kind of information. We build a centralized database, we build a portal, and so on. However, the situation is slightly more complicated. Some OAMs are private firms, which make money on the from the fact that they sell this information to the market. Some OAMs are central banks. Some OAMs are stock exchanges. Some OAMs are government entities. That didn't really work well for a centralized database. And there were multiple other factors which didn't really work for this particular concept. So having this entire environment of the IFRSs introduced as an accounting standards, as LEI for the identification of the company, and for the structured data, this XBRL format, this extensible business reporting language, which is used in quite a few countries around the world, we came up with a proposal back in March 2017 to the Commission. Let's think of a decentralized solution. how about we create a decentralized record of that information? It actually goes very much in line with what Ingmar was talking about. Let's create a record that will be coordinated across these registries that will not really store the data itself. The data still sits with the OEMs, but it will create this hash. It will indicate to the investors, it will create a pretty much a consistent record of that information accessible to the investors, and they will be able to search for that information based on several criteria. Now, the technology that was selected is pretty much this one that we are talking all about. And we came up with an idea. We do need to do a POC. We do need to test this concept because we don't know whether it will work. There are so many unknowns in this scheme. So we've selected annual financial reports. We took variety of formats of these submissions, variety of those formats of files that are used across the European Union. And pretty much we started shaping up the solution. And the solution was we need to give some sort of an access, some sort of an interface for investors, because we are starting with this business case and with my colleagues, Anne and the others that you have seen on the screen, pretty much. So they want to have access to that. They want to have, these are regular folks. They are looking for information. They need to have some sort of visual in order to access to this data on the ledger. So we started building that. And the concept was, if we put it on the cloud in addition, we'll make it quite, you know, sort of like secure. We may expect a couple of benefits which are additional. So if you look at this from this perspective, what we were looking for is create decentralized network of pointers to the same record of information. And this record was to be constantly filled with new updates from the different registers. From business perspective, what we wanted to store on the particular ledger was something that, for lack of better description, we called a token, or you know, metadata file. And this metadata file contained a couple of pieces of information. It contained an identifier of the company. It contained a name. It contained a couple of other pieces, like hash of the original file that was submitted, so the checksum, pretty much, control sum for the file. It contained also the link, so that we could directly sort of like point to the particular registry and guide the user, here you can get the information. We didn't actually prescribe whether the information would be accessible for free or for a charge or in whatever other circumstances. You could point directly to the file, or you could point more, you know, sort of like in an intermediary fashion to a system that you would have to log into and so on. And this proved to work quite well. So we defined this record of the metadata, and the assumption was OEMs will become the nodes of our network. So they will get this piece of software that is called the node client. We use the Ethereum public DLT. And this node client is actually a bit more sophisticated. I'll show you in a moment an architectural screen of that. It fulfills multiple functions over there. We assumed for the first stage, for the POC, that we don't give this right to the issuers to become the node, although that consideration was also taken into play. The entire project took 6 months, the POC. It started in August, more or less. It finished in January this year. And a team of approximately, I think, 15 or 20 people worked, and besides everything about this project is publicly available, so every one of you can actually go, including downloading the entire source code of the client. You just need to register as a European citizen on some European Commission portal, but that's pretty much all. So the entire documentation was built in approximately 6 months, and it took the budget of €350,000 to create it for the POC on the Ethereum. And we had a couple of those considerations. There are not only advantages of the DLT. There are actually a couple of those considerations. How do you distribute the keys? How do you make the OEMs those that can actually record information? And there are others who want to access the information on this network, only those who can, so to say, read from the information. So there are those access rights that you need to deal with. There are some aspects like in terms of resilience and immutability. Immutability is great, but what if we want to actually erase some record because there is a legal court order to erase some information? These kind of cases we also consider. So it's not as simple as it looks. It's a bit more complicated. However, it did prove that there is a really good sound basis and a very simple, very cheap, and very fast way to create a distributed database of sort that is synchronized, that is coordinated among multiple types of organizations in order to create one single view. And this view looks like that. They're pretty much the OAMs were, as I said, selected as the nodes. For the future, and this future sort of like begins pretty much right now, there is a next stage of the project that is being considered. We are looking also into the case where the issuers will become the nodes. So they will actually write directly to the ledger. This obviously, as you can imagine, as you can foresee, changes quite a lot and requires quite a few changes because the question what the role of the NCAs and OAMs, the NCAs, the national competent authorities, and the OAMs, officially appointed mechanisms, are under these circumstances and under this scenario. What the role of auditors are, and there are some really nice considerations, like if an auditor signs the hash of the file with their private key, then that means ultimately for the entire public, they can recognize with the public key of that particular auditor that it has been audited at this particular point of time. So there are really nice technological things that actually come to fulfill this solution and to actually equip the solution with a couple of more functions. The token is another big question over there, how to structure it, not only to contain the annual financial reports and indicate that, but let's say corporate actions, how about prospectuses, how about other types of data that can be actually recorded. And you will see in a moment a slide that is very far forward looking. However, in my personal opinion, and from everything that we are hearing, this actually presents the future of how this EFTG can be used. Technically speaking, you just create one piece of software and multiply it across the network. So you ask everyone to use exactly the same piece of software with some sets of APIs to make it interoperable with the local systems. And physically speaking, it's a very simple piece of open source type of program. So you can ask your programmers to actually write it, to download it from the network, from the Ethereum, for instance. We use Ethereum because our crypto folks were, so to say, most familiar with that, but you can use the other technologies as well. And then we created those portals so you can search for information based on the ADIs, names of companies, and so on. Obviously, it's fake information for the POC. It's been prepared for that. However, we also went a bit farther. If we wanted to streamline that and we wanted to make it even more useful for the folks, for my team from the beginning of the presentation, Anne, et cetera, how would we do that? We would have to equip this record with some information like assets, revenue, profit loss, so that they could search for information. Let's give me companies across Europe which operating profit is above 4 million, something like that. So we did that. We actually assumed that ESMA, under the European Single Electronic Format, the reports will come in inline XBRL. So we built into the node a little bit of piece of a software that is a parser that parsed the processed the inline XBRL file, took a couple of those structured data facts, and also recorded it on the blockchain along the other metadata information. So that provided for a very quick opportunity to search for this data. The technology of the DLT is something that is evolving, so there are others like BigchainDB, and possibly you will be in the future able to store the entire document on the ledger. We didn't find a particular use case for that. We found a use case for storing a couple of pieces of this information. And this leads us to this potential, which I personally think is the most important message I wanted to pass to you. One thing we looked at is the possibility to connect with the BRIS. And I had the presentation earlier today. This kind of mechanism in connection with the data from the business registers creates an even bigger story because listed companies have started somewhere and somewhen. They have not appeared just like that. They went through some IPOs. They went through some prospectuses. So they are also in the business registers databases. Another one is connecting it to the massive Glyph repository that Glyph operates, and they have beautiful sets of data and wonderful sets of data on level one, level two, that could be really nicely coupled with that in order to give a bit more searchability and queryability functions. Prospectuses is another thing. And most importantly, it's not a very visible slide, but that's probably the most important slide from my presentation. It tells you what can be done in a very, very simple way if you create this architecture in a repeatable, scalable way just by multiplying the node. So here we assumed that we wanted to cover the entire story about the particular firm or company from the moment that I, as Michael Piechowski, established it, for instance, a sole proprietorship. I registered with that entity, with that organization, obtained my first registration number. Then I register it with tax authority. I obtain some tax identification number. Then, let's say, I ask for a license to operate as a bank. Then I ask for a license to be for some exemptions. Then I participate in some procurements. Then I decide to go IPO. I list my company on this part. Then I issue some financial instruments. Then I'm obliged to submit corporate actions and annual financial reports and everything else. All these facts, without the data itself, can be recorded on the ledger. And step by step, I can, within the country or across the European Union, I can invite more and more registers to jump in and join this entire trend, just giving this piece of software, this node, to operate it at the moment they feel comfortable. They don't need to share the data with me, they just need to prepare this small piece that is the metadata component, that is the token, to record it. That's a very, very easy thing for the IT programmers in the registry. So they don't need to actually operate any crypto knowledge. They just prepare this package of information that goes on a ledger. What is, however, a prerequisite is to consider how the token will look like from the beginning, embracing all these different pieces of information to structure the token rightly. And there are ways to actually even make it extensible in a way. If you imagine what this can end up with, if sufficient number of those registries and sufficient numbers of those parties would chip in to record information on the same ledger, we would have the complete story or evolving dynamic reference data for all companies, for the entire company from the moment it emerges through all the stages, mergers, acquisitions, everything that is important for the company to assess it, including even some side chains, for instance, when a CRA gives a rating to the particular company. So we are not talking about storing the data centrally, we are talking about creating something like a Google platform, a virtual index of all the data that could be sitting in different registries by just multiplying the node. So with that, I would like to leave you. I'll be happy to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Okay, Mikhail, thank you. Jonas, please take two.